Thank you very much. I thought I'll be the complete party pooper here, but I am quite thankful that Professor Avineri and Dr. Kremer began to do the job for me. The truth of the matter is that in my view, all the celebrations around, the centenary celebrations around the Sykes-Picot Agreement are completely misconceived. The Sykes-Picot Agreement didn't have any impact, any direct impact whatsoever on the history of the Middle East for the simple reason that the Sykes-Picot Agreement never came into existence. It's enough to look at the map, and here Dr. Kremer showed a small section of the map relating to Palestine. It's enough to look at the Sykes-Picot map, which unfortunately is not on the wall, and the map of the Middle East to see that there is no connection. Had the Sykes-Picot Agreement been implemented, the Middle East had been a unified entity, not a Westphalian state system, because the Sykes-Picot Agreement envisaged what it called an Arab state or confederation of states, but in fact an Arab empire, which includes most of the territories that are today in Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Israel, and parts of Saudi Arabia. So obviously this agreement has never been implemented. What the agreement has caused, however, the damage that it has caused, that it has created a certain myth, very much created by a person mentioned by Dr. Kremer, George Antonius, a Syrian who lived in Palestine, and who wrote very articulate but totally historically, totally wrong and misconceived book called The Arab Awakening, and in which he said that the Sykes-Picot Agreement was a devious attempt to dismember the so-called Arab unity, the unity of the so-called Arab people. It was done behind the backs of the Arabs by the imperialist powers who divided the Middle East in accordance with their interests and in complete disregard of the yearnings of the local people. And due to his close relations with the British authorities at the time, this book has become really the narrative about Sykes-Picot, definitely among Arabs, because it suited their need to criticize the West and to blame the West for the ills of the Middle East, but among Middle East historians, journalists, politicians, and so on. And we see it today very much. So the fact of the matter is, as I said, the Sykes-Picot Agreement, A, didn't give even conceptually the idea of the Westphalian nation state, B, was never implemented, but led to a certain legacy. So let me just very quickly explain what the Sykes-Picot was about, how it came into being, and what came next. So the idea that the Sykes-Picot Agreement was, unabashed, Anglo-French attempt to dismember the Middle East is wrong again. The Sykes-Picot Agreement was basically a reactive action as a result of a chain of development. If we go a bit further back, at the outbreak of the First World War, there was no Anglo-French or Russian, for that matter, interest to dismember the Middle East. And in fact, they offered the Ottoman Empire a very clear deal, very specifically stated, you stay out of the war, you keep the empire. The Ottoman Empire didn't stay out of the war. As we know, they joined Germany, they're greedy. Now, a year after this, the British still didn't want to dismember the British Empire. There was the so-called the Bunsen Committee, it was a foreign office committee, which decided to keep the Ottoman Empire intact after the war, if in a somewhat more decentralized form. Now, about a bit later, an Arab potentate from Hijaz, from Mecca, Sharif Hussein of Mecca, the Hashemites, of the Hashemite family, he approached the British and they started negotiating about an Arab revolt, and at certain point in the negotiation, the British were very skeptical because they realized that Sharif Hussein of Mecca didn't represent anyone, but he managed to dupe them and to lead some people to believe that he would lead to a pan-Arab revolt against the Ottoman and so on and so forth. And he began negotiating with the British High Commissioner in Egypt, Sir Henry McMahon, and at certain point on the 24th of October, 1915, in this exchange of letters, McMahon wrote a letter which later became a cornerstone of the Arab claim against the British and Sykes-Picot. And in this letter, he vaguely accepted the territorial demands of the Hashemites, with a lot of qualifications on which they continue to argue in a series of other letters, but this was a very important letter. And by the way, the British Foreign Secretary Gray, a bit before the letter, warned him against making any specific commitments, but authorized him eventually to issue the letter. Now, as McMahon issued the letter, the British approached the French and asked to discuss the future of the Middle East. Now, France and England, of course, were allies in a major war. The Middle East was just a sideshow of a sideshow, as Lawrence of Arabia famously wrote in his book later. And they had an agreement from September 1914 that there would not be any unilateral decision that would affect the future of the world, in fact, without consulting the allies, that is England, France, and Russia. Now, Britain was negotiating behind the back of the French with some Arab potentate. And once it became more concrete, the British realized, oh, we have to bring the French into the picture so that we can get them to accept what will be agreed with Hussein. And this is the background of the Sykes-Picot. So Gray wrote to the French ambassador in London, Cambon, said, let's open negotiation. Cambon said, okay, and sent Picot, who was the counselor at the embassy at the time. He had been in Beirut before, so supposedly understood the Middle East. And they met a month later in November 1915. Picot met a lot of British foreign ministry officials. Sykes was not there yet. The French, he put his own position, the British put their own position, then they departed. They met a month later in mid-December, then Sykes joined the discussion, he established a good rapport with Picot, and then they continued to talk between themselves. So in a way, the Sykes-Picot agreement, as I said, was not suddenly the France and England decided to divide the Middle East. But it was a British attempt to get French acceptance of their promises to the Arabs. So it's not that they tried to cheat the Arab of any gains, but to get international acceptance to this. In January, Picot and Sykes reached a tentative agreement. They brought it to the foreign ministries. If you look at the minutes of the discussion, there was great disenchantment among British decision makers with the agreement. Nevertheless, a month later, they agreed to accept it. And then they said, okay, now we have to get the agreement of our third party, which is Russia. So they went, Sykes and Picot went to St. Petersburg to get the Russian agreement. Eventually, they got and the agreement was signed. So it's not, by the way, an Anglo-French agreement. It's an Anglo-French-Russian agreement. And Russia was to get substantial territories in what is today Turkey. Turkey, by the way, wouldn't have existed either if the Sykes-Picot agreement had been implemented. So this is the Sykes-Picot agreement. It was an agreement that was basically on the part of the British designed to get the other allies to accept the idea of an Arab empire after the war, and then they took for themselves certain territories that Dr. Kramer showed in Syria and Lebanon for France. In England took certain territories, including Baghdad. In Iraq and Russia got its territories, but the main body of the Middle East would have been Arabs. But no sooner had the agreement signed that the British started to undermine it. In December 1916, Lloyd George came to power. Lloyd George was a major opponent of the agreement. He said, I cannot understand how a man of the great intelligence like Sykes affixed his signature to such an agreement. Lloyd George actually approached the Turks and said, are you willing now to make a deal? You'll still be able to keep large part of the empire in certain ways. And the Turks rejected it, and once they rejected it, so then they went to undermine the agreement. Part of undermining the agreement was the Balfour Declaration. From the British point of view, the Balfour Declaration was a vehicle to undermine Sykes-Picot. There are other reasons, as we know, the normal reasons. They wanted American Jewry to influence America to enter the war. They thought that the Jews had influence in the communist movement, so they prevent Russia from leaving the war and so on and so forth. But a very important element from the British point of view was to undermine the status quo. In this respect, it coincided with the Zionist interest. Okay. Then after came, of course, the post-war agreements that were mentioned before, but these agreements are not generic to Sykes-Picot, they are opposed to Sykes-Picot. After the war, the agreements were basically designed to establish a new system. Now, this new system, and this is another issue which, again, they are signaling already, so I won't be very long, but it's a very important issue. These agreements were not imposed on the Middle East. The post-war agreements, which have nothing to do with Sykes-Picot, again, were not that the British and the French and the other victors were sitting and carving the Middle East, whereas the wishes of the local inhabitants were completely ignored. On the contrary, they're manipulated in it. If you look, why was Jordan established at the time, Transjordan? Because Emir Abdallah of the Hashemite family, who didn't get Iraq, managed to manipulate Britain to put him as a ruler there and eventually turned it into Jordan. Why was Iraq established? Iraq was established to accommodate Faisal, another Hashemite. And why was it unified? The British at certain point didn't want to unify Iraq. There was a big debate. Kurdistan, for example, other parts. It was, again, because of its champions in London. So in other words, not only did the Hashemites drive Britain into starting considering the dismantlement of the Ottoman Empire, then influenced them into establishing states of their behalf, but they eventually did it many times against the wishes of the British and the French. So I think we know what the Sykes-Picot legacy entails. It entails the accusation that the imperialist powers messed the Middle East. In fact, it's the opposite. It's the impact of the local powers on the great powers, their manipulation, sometimes directly, sometimes behind the scenes, into doing what they wanted, establishing a system that was much more in line with their wishes, which again doesn't necessarily represent the wishes of their subjects, but their wishes. And it is exactly because it was established as some kind of hybrid between the Westphalian nation state and the empire, and that it allowed the creation of what I call imperialist notion like Arab nationalism, pan-Islamism, and the right, that created a dissonance among these people that failed to bridge the gap between their affinities of local patriotism that existed at the time and the nation state. So the Arab states were established from the beginning, and their leaders told them that this is not the idea. The idea was the unification of the entire nation. And in this fact, if I can just complete by saying, ISIS, for example, these days is boasting of destroying the Sykes-Picot border. But if you really know the fact, you will see that what ISIS is trying is to reestablish the Sykes-Picot border and establish a state that